Hi, I'm Will Howard, and I recently had the great honor to be able to travel with Dr. John Stott through his lectures in Houston, Chattanooga, Washington, D.C. at the White House. We were able to take some time and do an interview with John one-on-one, and I'd like to share that with you today. John Stott was born in London in 1921 to Sir Arnold and Lady Stott. He was educated at Trinity College, earning a double first in French and theology, and was selected as a senior scholar. He was listed in Time magazine's 100 Most Influential People in 2005 and was named the Queen's New York Honors List as Commander of the Order of British Empire in the same year. He has written 50 books, some of which appear only in Chinese, Korean, or Spanish. He was lauded by biographer Alistair Chapman as the closest thing to an evangelical pope. John, what was the defining event of your childhood?
Well, of course, the defining event of my childhood was my birth, but I don't imagine it is that to which you're referring. I think otherwise, since you mentioned childhood, I would say that I can remember very vividly when I was first allowed to walk. I can remember the excitement I had. I felt that I was already almost grown up, that I was allowed to walk and not just be carried around in a cot, or whatever you call it. That was quite a defining moment for me.
When and how did you come to Christ, and at what age?
When I was almost 17. I like to say 17, it sounds a bit better, but I was 16 and three quarters, something like that. How? I was at one of these strange schools, which in England we call a public school, which, as you know, is not a public school, but a private one, called Rugby School, the school, in fact, where the rugby game was invented, where a boy called William Webb Ellis first picked up the ball and ran with it, thus originating the distinctive feature of the rugby game. And while I was at rugby, I was continuing to read the Bible, to quote, say my prayers, because my mother, who was brought up, my mother's mother was a German Lutheran. My mother was brought up in Lutheran piety. She brought my sisters and me up to say our prayers and go to church. And I continued to do that into my teens, but it was double Dutch to me. It didn't mean anything to me personally. But at the same time, I was a seeking soul. I knew there was something else to life than I had yet discovered. So I was invited by another boy to attend what maybe today we'd call a Christian Union meeting or something of that kind. And I started going to this. It was a meeting arranged by boys for boys on a Sunday afternoon at 3 o'clock. And one Sunday, we had a visiting preacher. And as far as I can remember, he preached on Pilate's question, what shall I do then with Jesus, who is called Christ? Well, this hit me between the eyes because I had no idea I had to do anything about Jesus, who is called Christ. He was part of the furniture of my mind. I believed in him, as everybody did. But the idea I had to do something about him was entirely novel. So I continued to ask this visiting clergyman questions, and he took me out for a drive in his car in order to answer my questions. He saw that I was a seeking soul. And he then proceeded to go through the way of salvation, to explain that I was a sinner, that I needed a savior, that Christ had died for me, that he'd risen again, that if I opened the door of my life and invited him, he would come in, and all that. Then he had the great wisdom to leave me alone. He did not in any way precipitate a decision. So I had the whole of the rest of that afternoon and evening to consider the implications, to count the cost of committing my life to Christ. And that night, at about 10 o'clock, when the other boys were in bed in the dormitory, I crept out of bed in the dark, knelt at my bedside. I told Jesus I'd made a mess of my life so far. I then asked for his forgiveness. I thanked him for his death and resurrection. I opened the door as well as I knew how and invited him to come in. I saw no flash of lightning. I heard no peals of thunder. No electric shock passed through my body. In fact, I felt nothing, so I hopped into bed and went to sleep. But the following day, I knew that something had happened to me. It took me actually weeks to discover what it was and to articulate what it was. But I knew that something had happened, and I began to explain it simply by saying that Jesus Christ, who had been on the outside of the door, was now on the inside as my Savior and Lord. And it's taken me 60 years to prove the reality of what happened that night, the 13th of February, 1938.
And when did you get that pull to go into the ministry?
Well, at that time, I was all set to go into the diplomatic or foreign service. Because I mentioned my mother's mother was German, we seem to have had a certain facility with European languages, and we talked German and French to one another a bit at home. And during the school holidays, I went for a month either to Germany or to France in order to familiarize myself with the languages. So it seemed natural I would go into the Foreign Office or the diplomatic. But after I'd come to Christ, the idea of spending my life in diplomatic compromise no longer appealed to me negatively, whereas positively, I was astonished that I'd reached the age of 17 and nobody had ever explained to me the gospel. And it was that sense of surprise, of amazement, that nobody had ever told me, that I felt a great desire to spend my life telling other people what nobody had told me. So the negative against the diplomatic service and the positive pull to tell others about Christ corresponded with one another.
How were you sure it was Christ calling you to the ministry?
I don't think I was sure, but it's just step by step. I went up to Cambridge University as an undergraduate when I left Rugby School, and the more I came to read about Christ, the more I came to study, the more I came to mix with other Christians and understand more clearly what it meant to be a Christian, the more, step by step, it seemed to me logical that I should go forward and offer for the pastoral ministry, the ordained ministry.
And what do you appreciate about your years at Cambridge University?
It was wartime, so Cambridge University, like all the universities, was a shadow of its former self. There were games, but not too many. Everybody was very serious. They were studying hard. And I think that's what I value most, looking back to my Cambridge days, that I learned the discipline of study. I studied a great deal on my own. I know during my last year at Cambridge, I didn't go to a single lecture. In fact, I can remember walking down the street one day and bumping into one of my lecturers, and he stopped me and looked me up and down and said, "Let me see, you came to one of my lectures once, didn't you?" And I had to confess I had done. But some of my lecturers were really not very original, and I knew the books from which they got their material, so I thought it was more sensible to go straight to the source of their wisdom without having it filtered through them. So I learned to study on my own and to study so many hours a day without interruption and without needing to stop.
What mortal person has had the greatest influence on your life?
Well, I would have to mention again the man who led me to Christ, the man who preached that afternoon at Rugby School on "What Shall I Do Then with Jesus?" His name is the Reverend E.J. H. Nash. For some extraordinary reason, the young people who went to the house parties and camps that he organized called him Bash. I've no idea why, but everybody called him Bash, and he's known by that name. Well, he not only explained the way of salvation with quite extraordinary clarity, but I know he continued to pray for me, and I also know that he wrote to me once a week for 5 years. He had an extraordinary degree of faithfulness to those he'd helped to find Christ. So he led me on. I was a rather wayward young Christian, but he knew what it was to rebuke me when I needed rebuke, as well as to encourage me when I needed encouragement. So much so that when I saw his handwriting on the envelope, I sometimes had to pray for half an hour before opening it. But I thank God for his faithfulness. He's been in heaven for a number of years now, but he remained a loyal, faithful friend all those years.
Who was your greatest inspiration?
Alive or dead?
Doesn't matter.
Well, obviously you will leave out Jesus Christ himself, but I would want to say at this stage, I think, that I learned very early on that Christianity is not a religion and it is not an institution. It is a person. And it was enormously helpful to me to discover that Christianity is Christ and that what matters is a personal relationship to Christ. So that verses in the New Testament that came to mean much to me were Philippians 3, verses, I think, 8 and 9, where the Apostle Paul says that what was gain to me, I counted loss for Christ. Indeed, I have counted all things but loss in comparison with the overwhelming gain of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I've suffered the loss of all things, Paul went on, and count them but refuse or rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness based on law, but the righteousness that comes from God through faith in Christ. It's all Christ, 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 you know, knowing him, loving him, serving him, trusting him, gaining him. To me to live is Christ, Paul said, and I think, I hope without boasting, I can say the same. It is a person.
How do you communicate with Christ?
Well, different Christians claim different things. I am not one who can claim to hear audible voices or to receive messages from him in any kind of direct rather than indirect way. I am convinced that the Bible, as the Word of God, is the chief and most direct, although it is indirect, way in which Christ speaks to us. I know, of course, in his great allegory of the Good Shepherd and the sheep, he says, "My sheep, hear my voice and follow me." I don't think he meant that they hear audibly his voice. Anyway, that's beyond my experience. My experience is when I'm reading, a verse becomes luminous, or my heart burns within me when he opens to me the scriptures. So it's through scripture that his voice comes to me.
When did you first think about writing?
Well, actually, I never did, in the sense that it was never my idea. I suppose that's not quite true, because even when I was at Rugby, public school education encourages young students to learn to express themselves and to articulate things. So we wrote what were called essays. And I ended up as the head boy of the school, and as that I had to write a leading article every month in the school magazine. And while I was still at Cambridge, I was invited to contribute an article to a Christian magazine on how to lead children to Christ. So there was a little background of writing articles and so on. But the idea of writing a book had never occurred to me until when I was ordained, the Bishop of London, who ordained me, I suppose because I'd got this first-class degree, he wanted to encourage the leaders of the church to allow me time in which to continue with my studies. And to my utter astonishment, 2 years later, I received a personal letter from him inviting me to contribute what was then called the Bishop of London's Lent book. The Bishop of London commissioned a book which he encouraged the faithful in his diocese to read during the season of Lent. So he invited me to contribute a book as his Lent book. And as I wondered what to write about, I decided to write on the New Testament, a book that is still in print and is called Men with a Message. These were the New Testament writers. And my concern in the book was to demonstrate that each New Testament writer had been shaped by the Holy Spirit in such a way that he could convey through each writer a distinctive and appropriate truth. So that it's not an accident that Paul was the apostle of grace and faith, that John was the apostle of love, that Peter was the apostle of hope, and so on. Their distinctive message was worked out by the Holy Spirit within their own experience. So Men with a Message was my first book.
How many books have you written?
Well, do you know, I've never counted. I've often thought that to count my books would be equivalent to the sin of David in numbering the people. So I've never done it. The idea of counting your books and gloating over the number you've written seems to me to be a rather unpleasant concept. But my secretary, Francis Whitehead, who's been my secretary for 45 years and belongs on that account to the Noble Army of Martyrs, my secretary, Frances, is very diligent, and I think she's counted them, and she says there are more than 40. It depends very much on what you include as a book, and whether you include books that have been published in Spanish and Chinese, for example, which have never been published in English.
Do you have any idea how many books were printed or published or distributed throughout the world?
In the world and in history?
Yes.
No, I'm afraid I haven't.
Where do you find it comfortable to do your writing?
Well, I've always found it very difficult to write in London. London is a very feverish city, and the noises of London and callers and telephones and all the rest are not friendly to sustained concentration in reading and writing. So in 1952, when I was on my summer holidays with a number of friends, I decided, or they and I together decided, that we would visit Pembrokeshire, which is a county in the southwest tip of Wales. The only reason, humanly speaking, why we decided to go there was that none of us had ever been. And as we pored over the map, there seemed to be villages there far, far, far from the madding crowd. And we chose a little village called Dale in Pembrokeshire, right on the ocean. And one friend and I arrived there late on a Saturday night in the pouring rain. So it was impossible to put out our tents, because we used to go tenting in those days. So we got permission from a local farmer to doss down in his barn, which was full of rats. And all through the night we heard them pitter-patting, you know, along the beams and jumping into the grain. I don't think my friend had a moment's sleep all night. And he was quite ready to go back to London the following day. But we woke to one of those beautiful Pembrokeshire mornings when the sun was glittering and scintillating on the water of the bay and the ocean beyond. And we walked along, I'm sorry to give you a long answer to this, but we walked along the footpath, the coastal footpath, very close to the sea, looking for a sheltered place where it would be safe to pitch our tents. And there was only one place that we could find. It was a beautiful little valley with a stream running down it, very sheltered from the prevailing southerly wind. So we went to the local landlord and asked if for his permission to pitch our tents. And he gave us permission. And there we camped, in my case, for the best part of a month. And I fell in love with the place. It was an old farmhouse with a cluster of farm buildings. So I asked him, the landlord, before I went back to London, if this place ever comes on the market, I would be interested to hear about it. Do you want me to abbreviate, or is it all right?
Well, I'm delighted with every word you're saying. Tell me the whole story.
Well, the story is, he said, okay, and I heard nothing. He didn't write to me. And for 2 years, So I concluded that God didn't want me to become an owner of land, a landowner, and I put it away from me. But then, after 2 years, I suddenly had a note from a local estate or real estate agent saying that it was on sale for £2,000. So I had it surveyed and was advised to offer £500. So I did offer £500, but the tragedy was that he sold it to somebody else for £550 without coming back to me. So once again, I thought, well, maybe God doesn't want me to have a property. But then the man who had bought it was posted to another job in another part of the country, so he no longer needed it. So he wrote to me and said, do you still want it? So I bought it for what he'd paid for it, £550. Now, I never had any idea at that point that I would use it as a refuge for writing. I regard it as an amazing case of serendipity that I found what I was not looking for. And I've had it now for nearly 50 years. Well, it's actually no longer mine because I've given it now to the Langham Trust, which has supported my ministry all these years. But I have a little study there, which is a triangular-shaped room. It has a kind of studio window where my desk is, and I look out through the window to Westdale Bay and beyond it to the open Atlantic. In fact, I look due south to the South Pole. You can almost see it sticking out of the water. So there I've written nearly all my books, and I can work there all day, every day, without any disturbance. Nobody walks by. I was not on the telephone until 3 years ago, and didn't get on electricity until 2 years ago. So it's been very primitive, but gloriously isolated. And many friends come down and visit me, and other people use the house.
Has it played a role in your ministry?
It's played a unique role in my ministry. I thank God constantly. I think I'm the luckiest man on earth to have this retreat where I can go and study and write.
What do you envision for the future of this home?
Well, as I say, I've given it to the Langham Trust, and they have decided, the trustees, that is, have decided to update it, upgrade it, because it's been a bit primitive. So they want to add running water, showers to every room, a basin, and so on, and to generally make it more habitable. The idea is it will accommodate, when it's finished, about 15 people, and will be extremely suitable for small study groups of people who want to enjoy what you might call a study holiday. I've done that a lot myself, inviting a number of people to join me. And we work in the morning. We have the morning for study. And then the afternoon we may do some manual work on the property, some concreting, some work of that kind. And then we have an extended 2 or 3 hours of fellowship in the evening, in which we share each other's stories and so on. And we want to make this place, or the Langham Trust want to make this place available to other people. And while I'm still alive, they want me to continue to have my own study, and next door to it, my secretary's office, so that we can be independent while 15 people can be there at the Hookses, it's called. The Hookses, a strange name, but that's what the local people call it.
When did you first start traveling internationally, and why?
Well, by international travel, I take it you don't mean going to Scotland, Wales, or Ireland, but you mean going to other countries of Europe, and in particular, further afield. My first journey was in 1956. I was invited by the InterVarsity Christian Fellowships of Canada and the United States to cross the pond and to lead 8 missions, university missions. 4 in the States and 4 in Canada. The first was in Toronto, and the others in Canada were London, Ontario, and the University of British Columbia, and the University in Winnipeg. And then the 4 in the States were Harvard, Illinois, I can't just remember now. One is in Michigan, Ann Arbor in Michigan, the University of Michigan, and one more. And these, one, it was an exhausting experience to lead, but I was leading university missions all over the world at that time. And following those eight university missions, I was invited to lead one in Cambridge, another in Oxford, another in London, and then I did a series in Africa, and then another series in Asia, and then in Australia, New Zealand. Indeed, from 1952 to 1977, that's 25 years, I had the privilege of leading 50 university missions around the world. And basic Christianity is much of the material which I used at that time in university missions.
What was your most memorable trip?
Well, from what point of view? Any point of view?
Most special trip to you?
I mean, I think I would have to say to the Arctic, although there are not too many human beings there to evangelize. There are Eskimos, or as they like to be called, Inuit. But you may know that I'm a bird watcher. This is my main hobby of bird watching and bird photography. And every bird watcher wants to go to the Arctic because there are unique birds which breed in the Arctic and which winter down south. And for some reason or other, I've had the great desire to get to know and to see and to photograph the snowy owl. The snowy owl, I know it's sometimes seen down south in the United States in the winter, but I wanted to see it in its natural habitat in the summer. It's a circumpolar bird. They are to be found all around the North Pole, that is to say in the Canadian Arctic, in... I can't think what they're called. What's your new your state up there in
Alaska?
In Alaska, in Lapland, in Russian Siberia, all around. So nobody knows how many people there are because they nest in these uninhabited areas of the tundra. But some friends and I found a nest one day, and I spent a whole week in its company because it's the land of the midnight sun. I could sit in my blind and photograph this bird at midnight, at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in the morning. It was still light enough for photography. And to be maybe 15 to 20 feet away from this spectacular bird, pure white with black markings, and to watch its activity is beyond description.
Tell me about your visit with the Reverend Billy Graham.
It's a great privilege to stay in their rural country home at Montreat, North Carolina. And an amusing incident during that time is that Ruth, I suppose it was, had arranged for me to have a Christmas stocking because I was far from home for Christmas. And as I undid the stocking and took various things out, the most amazing thing to me was a rich wrist watch created by Longines, the famous Swiss watchmakers. I was very proud of this for many years. But there was also a strange thing in this Christmas stocking that seemed to me to spell a deodorant. And I thought, I don't know what that is. Dio, well, Dios, I suppose, is God. Dorant is a gift of God. Until somebody explained to me it was a deodorant. And I had never heard of deodorants before. I don't know that they'd come to England yet. But I found a deodorant in my Christmas stocking. And I've always been grateful to Billy Graham for introducing me to these things.
How did your international scholarships evolve?
Well, I think it is that in my travels in the third or developing world, I came across a number of very bright young scholars. I think I have to say that at that time, I'm talking about the early 1960s, I had no idea that God was raising up leadership in the developing world of this quality. men and to a lesser extent women at that time, but they had this terrific ability. And I met one or two, I'm thinking of one in India and one or two in Africa, who longed to be able to take their studies further, in fact to get a doctorate, but had no means of doing so. There seemed at that time to be no organization which was offering grants or scholarships for people. So as I listened to their stories, I determined to do something about it. And when I got back to England, I joined with some other friends in launching what came to be called the Langham Trust. Its sister movement in this country was the Langham Foundation, and it's now called John Stott Ministries because it includes offering scholarships to young men and women to help them to get a doctorate and go back to their country to teach in seminary. We regard the seminary as the key institution in the church because it's in the seminary that the future pastors of the church are either made or marred, either equipped and inspired or ruined. So that's how it all started.
Tell us about your International Evangelical Literature Trust.
Well, after the publication of Men with a Message that we talked about a little while ago, I started receiving invitations from other publishers, InterVarsity and other publishers, to contribute different books. So I started receiving book royalties. But I was a pastor in a local church with an adequate, nothing to write home about, but an adequate salary, and I didn't feel the need of these further royalties. So I went to a lawyer friend and an accountant friend in order to ask what I could do to start a private foundation of my own so that I could recycle my royalties, so that royalties I was receiving from books could be reused in publishing and distributing books. And now for a number of years, all my royalties have gone into the Evangelical Literature Trust. And because I sign a document when I sign the contract to the book, and the document is my royalties irrevocably to the trust, the Evangelical Literature Trust. In that way, I don't have to pay tax on my royalties because they go straight to a charity.
How did the name of your foundation change?
Well, it's always embarrassed me. It was known as the Langham Foundation, but my friends in the Langham Foundation often said years ago that nobody knows what Langham is. The word doesn't mean anything to anybody over here in the States. And I've always had to explain that the church to which I've belonged all these years is called All Souls, Langham Place, London, England. So Langham Place is actually the street on which All Souls Church is situated. So it's very well known in England and in a number of former British colonies. The word Langham is well known and accepted. But the friends in the Langham Foundation over here were not happy with it and wanted to make it more acceptable to American people. So on one occasion when I missed the board meeting and was absent, they took a unanimous decision in my absence to change the name to John Stott Ministries. Well, that title is exceedingly embarrassing in England. We have nobody in Britain who calls themselves by their own name, you know. But as I thought about it, and I received a long letter from a friend who is now the chairman of JSM, as we call it, explaining that there was a need to change it and asking that I would agree. So since it was unanimous and they gave their reasons, I felt I had to give in.
What do you believe is the state of preaching today?
Miserable. Abysmal.
Why?
Well, let me begin by saying that I'm an unrepentant believer in the power of the pulpit. I believe in preaching. I know it's regarded by many people as an outmoded form of communication, as what somebody's called an echo from an abandoned past. who wants to listen to sermons nowadays? You know, people are drugged by television. They are hostile to authority. They are weary and wary of words. And they don't want to listen to sermons. But I believe that it's possible to recapture the sermon as an authentic means of communication today. There is something unique about preaching when you have a living person facing living people, as hopefully a spirit-filled preacher addressing spirit-filled people, that there is a chemistry, there is something that happens that doesn't happen on television or even on other forms of communication. So I believe that there is something about preaching that is unique, and I want to see it captured. So why is it so rare today? That is biblical preaching. Preaching to me must be maybe not expository in the sense of going through a long passage of scripture and giving a running commentary on it. I don't mean that. But that every sermon must be a biblical exposition. It must wrestle with a passage of scripture, a verse, a paragraph. So the reason why biblical preaching is so important is that it is the exposition of the Word of God, and it is the Word of God that needs to come to people. It's the Word of God that challenges people and that matures the people of God. As Jesus said, human beings don't live by bread only, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And if that's true of individuals, it's equally true of churches. Churches live and grow and flourish by the word of God, and they languish and die without it. So we must bring the word of God to the people of God if the people of God are to grow into maturity in Christ. So why don't more people do it? Well, I know why I'm tempted not to do it is laziness. It is because there is no form of preaching that is more demanding on one's time and energies than biblical exposition, because we have to wrestle at great length with the text until we are as sure as we can be that we've understood it. And then we have to go on wrestling not only with the text but with the application of the text to the modern world. So I've often called preaching relating the ancient text to the modern world. And that means study on both sides of the cultural divide. And that's very taxing, very demanding. And because pastors, all of us, are very busy people, and we need to find something that perhaps we can give up, preaching is often the first thing.
Do you have any recommendations for young preachers or preachers who want to excel?
Well, the first thing young preachers need in going out to the task is to be convinced of its necessity, to be convinced of the power and the relevance of biblical preaching. Only that will motivate them to do it. The second thing I would want to say to them is give yourself time. It's not possible to be a biblical preacher if you skimp the time. So what you need to do once you've chosen your text, and the process of choosing the text is another question, but once you know what your text is, then you need to read it and reread it and reread it and go on turning it over and over and over in your mind, meditating on it, you know, asking yourself two questions. One, what does it mean? And two, what does it say? What does it mean is its meaning, and what it does say is what it did say, and what it did say is what it does say. The meaning of a text does not change with the changing years. It remains the same. The meaning of a text is established by the author of the text. A text means what its author meant. And then, having asked what does it mean, the second question is what does it say? That is, we turn from its meaning to its message. And there we have to think about our congregation. Who are we going to preach to next Sunday? Are they young married couples? Are they teenagers? Are they elderly people who've retired? We try and envisage, visualize in our mind who these people are And then comes the excitement of relating what it means to what it says, or the ancient meaning to the modern message.
How do you choose a text?
Well, there are several different ways in which to choose a text. The best one, I believe, is that we engage, maybe not all the time, but very often, in expounding a whole book of the Bible, or maybe the whole of the Sermon on the Mount, or the Upper Room Discourse, or the Epistle to the Philippians, or the Book of Jonah, or whatever. So if we are expounding a whole book and maybe taking 20 or 30 Sundays over it, then our text is given us. We know what it was last week, then we know what it's going to be this week. It's the next part of that's the most healthy way in which to decide on a text. The second one, I suppose, is the season of the year. Even if churches are not liturgical churches, many of them will observe, they'll observe Christmas and Good Friday and Easter Day and Ascension Day and Pentecost and so on. That's the second way. And the third way, I think, is that we need to preach out of our own experience. And while we're reading and studying the Bible every day, and ideas for sermons come to us while we're reading, I think it is a good idea to allow one's mind to follow. We all of us have momentary flashes of inspiration, sometimes at the most awkward moments, when somebody else is speaking, or on the top of a bus, or in the middle of the night. And I always say, seize these moments of inspiration. They're all too rare. But when we get them and God seems to be speaking to us, then I want to get out of bed and get out the notepad I keep at the side of my bed always and write down. Sometimes I prepare sermons in my dreams. My secretary is always very amused with this, and my study assistant. But I do. Sometimes while I'm dreaming, the sermon takes shape, you know. And then, of course, I write it down immediately I've woken up. So seize the moment of inspiration. There are three ways in which we find our text. The best one, I believe, is that we engage, maybe not all the time, but very often, in expounding a whole book of the Bible, or maybe the whole of the Sermon on the Mount, or the Upper Room Discourse, or the Epistle to the Philippians, or the Book of Jonah, or whatever. So if we are expounding a whole book and maybe taking 20 or 30 Sundays over it, then our text is given us. We know what it was last week, then we know what it's going to be this week. It's the next part of that's the most healthy way in which to decide on a text. The second one, I suppose, is the season of the year. Even if churches are not liturgical churches, many of them will observe, they'll observe Christmas and Good Friday and Easter Day and Ascension Day and Pentecost and so on. That's the second way. And the third way, I think, is that we need to preach out of our own experience. And while we're reading and studying the Bible every day, and ideas for sermons come to us while we're reading, I think it is a good idea to allow one's mind to follow. We all of us have momentary flashes of inspiration, sometimes at the most awkward moments, when somebody else is speaking, or on the top of a bus, or in the middle of the night. And I always say, seize these moments of inspiration. They're all too rare. But when we get them and God seems to be speaking to us, then I want to get out of bed and get out the notepad I keep at the side of my bed always and write down. Sometimes I prepare sermons in my dreams. My secretary is always very amused with this, and my study assistant. But I do. Sometimes while I'm dreaming, the sermon takes shape, you know. And then, of course, I write it down immediately I've woken up. So seize the moment of inspiration. There are three ways in which we find our text.
John, can you sum up what God's calling has been for you throughout your life?
I think I would have to say what, in fact, we've just been talking about, which is the call to relate the ancient word to the modern world. I've often told people, and have written in the book Between Two Worlds, which is about preaching, a conversation I had with two students many years ago which actually became definitive in shaping my own ministry. These two students were brothers who had been brought up in the same conservative religious home, and they had inherited the faith of their parents during their boyhood. But now they were students at university. One was at Oxford University, the other was at Edinburgh University in Scotland. And they told me that they had renounced the faith of their parents. One said he was an atheist, and the other said he was an agnostic. So I naturally pricked up my ears, and I said to them, well, tell me, what has happened to you? Why have you given up the faith of your parents? And this is how they replied. They said, Christianity is a primitive Palestinian religion. It arose in a primitive Palestinian culture. So what on earth has it got to say to us who live in the exciting modern world? And they began to describe the modern world with increasing excitement. They said, we have men on the moon in the 70s, which is when they were talking to me. And they said, we shall have men on Mars in the 80s. They were a little optimistic. They said, we have transplant surgery today. We shall have genetic engineering tomorrow. And they get all, all excited over the modern world. And then with a sneer, almost a leer on their face, they said, what is your primitive Palestinian religion got to say to us? It's irrelevant. That conversation with those two students has had an enormous influence in my developing ministry. I saw then with crystal clarity the task of the Christian communicator, which is not just to expound the Word of God, but to go beyond exposition to application. I started studying the modern world as well as the ancient world of the Bible, in order to relate the one to the other. I started a reading group in London. I invited a dozen young professionals, a couple of doctors, an architect, some teachers, and so on, to meet me every so often, and we would agree on the secular book that we would all read before we met again. And then we would go around the room, and each one would contribute, just maybe for a few seconds only, how they see the challenge of this secular book to the Christian gospel. And we'd end our evening by asking ourselves, how does the biblical gospel relate to people who think like this or live in this kind of world and culture? So I can only say over the years, it's been enormously helpful and challenging to me. These young people have really dragged me into the modern world. So that's the first thing. The second thing is I think my own preaching increasingly became related to issues of the modern world. And I think of the book called Issues Facing Christians Today, which actually began as a series of sermons on issues facing Britain today. One a month, I think we did, for more than a year. Then there are other things that have developed, which I'd like to mention. One is a series of expositions called The Bible Speaks Today. Now that very title is significant. The Bible Speaks Today. What is its contemporary message? And I've had the privilege of editing the New Testament section of The Bible Speaks Today, published by the InterVarsity Press. And then some years ago in 1982, I think it was, the London Institute for Contemporary Christianity was founded, and I had a hand in the founding of it, and the London Lectures in Contemporary Christianity. Now, by contemporary Christianity, we don't mean some newfangled Christianity that we're busy inventing. By contemporary Christianity, we mean biblical, classical, apostolic Christianity that is sensitively related to the modern world. So in these and other ways, I think my ministry for the last 40 years probably has taken this direction of how can we struggle to understand the ancient word, to understand the modern world, and then sensitively to relate the one to the other. I sum it all up by saying that our preaching must be characterized by faithfulness and sensitivity. Faithfulness to the biblical text, sensitivity to the modern context.
John, can you give us a background on your ministry with All Souls Church in London?
Well, my experience has been very unusual. I recognize that. Most people serve 3, 4, 5 churches during their lifetime, and I've been attached to the same church for the whole of my life. When I was 2 years old, my parents brought my sisters and me to Harley Street, which is the Doctor Street round the corner from All Souls Church, and we began to attend All Souls Church. I'm afraid I was a very naughty little boy at that time in my pre-unregenerate days, and my sister, who was almost a twin, we were very close to one another, and I used to sit up in the gallery of the church. In those days, it was a very fashionable church, and people were very well dressed, you know. And so my sister and I used to make pellets out of bus tickets and drop them onto the fashionable hats of the ladies below. And little did I think at that time that one day I would occupy the pulpit. But such is the grace, the regenerating and transforming grace of God. Anyway, I continued to attend All Souls Church as a boy, a child, until I went to a boarding school, and then I attended only during the holidays. And then the rector of All Souls, while I was coming to the end of my student days at Cambridge, asked whether I would consider beginning my ordained ministry in the church I knew so well. And after talking and thinking and praying about it, I accepted his invitation. So I was ordained into the Church of England pastorate in 1945, just after the end of World War II. And I began what we call a curacy, which is an assistant pastorship, at All Souls Church. Now, within a year or two of my arriving there, my rector, who is a senior pastor, had a coronary thrombosis, a heart attack, and was away from the parish for 6 months. So I was thrown in at the deep end and had to take some responsibility to be in charge of the church when I was totally unfit for it. Well, then he recovered and he came back. Then he had another one. Then he came back. Then he had a third one, which killed him. And that, all that took 5 years. I couldn't leave. I was invited to do a number of different things, to go as a pastor to this church and that church, to become a chaplain at Eton College, to go to the East End of London in the slums and so on. But I couldn't accept any of these invitations because my rector was ill and he needed me to be there with him. So when he died, I was expecting that I would be released and go to another church. But to my utter astonishment, I was appointed to succeed him. So I found myself at the tender age of 29, the rector of this very large and significant church in the West End of London. And I remained rector for 25 years. Then I honestly believed that I'd given all I could to the church, and the church needed a change of leadership. So I resigned, and Michael Bourne was appointed to succeed me. He later became a bishop, Bishop of Chester. And he very kindly said that he didn't only want to take over the leadership himself, but he wanted me set free to travel, to preach and teach and lecture, while at the same time becoming rector emeritus of All Souls. So from 1975 until today, I've been rector emeritus. So I started 5 years as curate, 25 as rector, and the remaining years as rector emeritus, which I still am.